pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening. Today is Tuesday, July 12, 2022, the time being 5:30 p.m. The meeting of the Greensburg Board of Works is called to order. At this time, please silence all electronic devices. Declare Title VI of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. The city requests that participants in this meeting complete a voluntary anonymous survey and survey a long table in the back of the room. Amy, would you please call the roll?
Mayor Joshua Marsh.
Here.
Rodney King.
Present.
Glenn Tebbe.
Present.
Karen D. Rust. Here.
I did know Jamie would be absent this evening. You all should have received a copy of the minutes from June 14, 2022. Any additions, edits, or corrections? If not, we'll take a motion to approve those as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's been made by Glenn, second by Rodney. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed. The old business we have, Cam Troxell is here with us this evening, first person. This was something that was tabled last month as well. Cam, I'll let you sort of talk about your company a little bit. Everybody's kind of been briefed about it a little bit, but I'll turn it over to you.
Sure. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for the time and the opportunity, and also appreciate your flexibility. I know last month we tried to get this on the docket. Had it on the docket, but I ran into some issues personally with the kids and having to be at home versus here, so I appreciate your flexibility. A little bit about me. I'm a small-town Indiana guy myself. I currently reside on the north side of Indianapolis. I work for a company called First Person, also known as NFP. We were recently acquired within the last 12 to 15 months. We're all things people business. So any organization, many organizations have anywhere from one to many thousands of employees. We help employers identify needs or gaps within the employer-employer relationship and help to solve problems within that relationship. A little bit about, you know, from an agenda, who we are, what we've heard in the interaction that we've had with the mayor and other members of the city's team here. Talk to you about some opportunities that we've got in front of us from our perspective, if you will, and then we can discuss next steps. So, like I said, anything in that employee-employer relationship is really in our wheelhouse. At its backbone, we have employees. So anything from an insurance perspective, medical, dental, vision, life, etc., that's kind of the core of our business. There are some other things that kind of coincide with that, right? So when we're talking about total rewards or an employee's relationship with the employer, there's obviously compensation that's a big part of that relationship. Also, you know, from a benefit plan perspective, from a labor perspective, there are a litany of compliance-related matters that we need to make sure that employers are you know, at the bar they need to be on those things. Human resources strategy and health strategy are also things that dovetail into some of the work that we frequently find ourselves doing with our clients. Just a little bit about the broader NFP ecosystem. We're over 6,000 employees. We're the fifth largest global firm, but don't think of us as this massive animal necessarily, because we've got 60 employees here in Indiana that are, you know, core to all of the services needed within the state and all of the client base within the state. A little bit about some of the groups that we work with that would be more peer-to-peer to you all. We work with a litany of cities and towns. We actually have a peer group that we stood up that I talk about a little bit on the next slide, but lots of the groups in and around the donut counties of Indianapolis, as well as a little bit further reaching out the state of Indiana are groups that we frequently consult with. We have a cities and towns peer group. We meet with this group quarterly. It's really designed to grab HR professionals, leadership from respective communities that have interest in talking about things that are really specific to the challenges that cities and towns face with regard to their employees and all the fairs that happen. So we talk about organizational structure, HR technology, employee benefits, mental health, learning and development, communication, things like that. All right, as part of our conversation, our exploration with the mayor and other members of the team, things that we've heard, you see opportunity within health plan for maybe potentially improving strategic management. We really want to make sure that we're building a solid foundation from a compensation perspective so that you're retaining and you're able to retain and hire your employees at the right level that you want to. And then you have a potential desire to focus on someone that can help long term. This total rewards halo is just kind of how we look at the employer-employee relationship. That relationship is through the lens of the employee, and if you think of this as an eye, an employee may have their vision on any one of these things throughout that relationship. Really, our biggest focus is on the top right-hand side of that with the compensation, benefits, and well-being side of the world. Knowing full well that all of these other things, leadership effectiveness for learning and development, things like that, are also part of that equation. So a couple of recommended focus areas. For today's purposes, we're going to focus on benefits strategy and compensation structure. Results Builder is a process that we use. It's nothing more than our tool that we use to gather information, consolidate that information into a coherent set of findings, presenting findings to respective constituents, and recommending, you know, any sort of actions to be taken to improve, you know, any manner of the things that we identify. I'm going to gloss over this again. I want to be brief. I want to be mindful of your time here. So just from a life cycle perspective, when we work, oftentimes we work on the benefits for many employers, and we work like, you know, like a clock. And we talk about everything relative to the benefits enrollment or the benefits renewal, and we work everything from the renewal through open enrollment all the way around the calendar cycle just to make sure that both our clients and us are all on the same song sheet, if you will. Oftentimes we found that if we just focus on things during that renewal and that open enrollment period, there's a lot of things that fall through the cracks for the rest of the calendar year. So we make sure that we're doing things in a life cycle that supports all the activities necessary to be really successful. All right, so what is on the table, or what are things that we've discussed? I know there's been a lot of discussion amongst many of you and council members and others to talk about, you know, where your interests may lie. The mayor and I had an opportunity to touch base, and you know, we think about this in two ways: health benefit strategy and compensation. Those things are tightly interconnected because they're part of the total compensation or the total value of the relationship between an employer and employee. So if we think about that in the context of how we might support you on the benefit side, we can look at network analysis. That is basically an assessment of where your folks are utilizing facilities and laboratory services and pharmacy or prescription drugs, and looking at all those things to make sure that you're positioned as favorably as you can from a contractual perspective to get the best value for the dollars that you're spending on those things. We can model plan design. If there are desires or interests to evaluate plan design, we can take into account where you would benchmark your plans relative to your peers, both locally, but then also other cities and towns throughout the state to see where you stack up and make sure that you stack up truly where you want to stack up. We work with many employers that want to be average. We work with many employers that maybe pay a little bit more and are okay being a little bit below average on benefits. And the inverse is true as well, where employers want to be better on benefits and maybe sacrifice on the pay side a little bit. A particular area that I think could be interesting is looking at your stop loss arrangement on your self-funded health plan. We actually are standing up a cities and towns stop loss captive. Basically what that means is we pool the cities and towns together from a stop loss perspective, still remain completely autonomous with regard to the benefits that you offer your employees. You don't have to change anything with regard to that. It's purely banding belly weight together, so many cities and towns coming together to increase purchasing power with the stop-loss market. And one of the upsides to it too is being a captive, there's a layer of insulation in the premium at that point where there could be a return of overfunded plan. So if the captive performs well and it's overfunded, you could get a return. Again, all we would do there is look at the quoting process to see if that would make sense for you all at this point in time. It's not to say we're absolutely doing this. This is purely a study basis, if you will. And then again, benchmark analysis. We can benchmark your benefits, employer versus employee cost share, the value of the benefits, sufficiency of coverage, which you know, that's on the disability side of things, how much choice architecture there exists in the benefits, and then whether or not, you know, an HSA type plan would be a value for your employees or for the city. I'll run past the data needed. That's more of a administrative matter for the folks in the HR team and what have you. And then just talk about compensation really fast. We utilize a heavy amount of data on the compensation side. Much of what I said on the benefits side holds true on the compensation side. It's really about benchmarking where you are at in terms of compensation for the respective job classifications and jobs that you have. We have taken just a really high level look at how many jobs you all have within your ecosystem, if you will. So we collect the job description, we collect a lot of information from you, and we balance that against our benchmarking resources. You know, for you all, we'd suggest doing approximately 35 jobs. If we do the full benchmarking, we usually recommend 60 to 75% of the total jobs within an employer to do a analysis of how well you stack up. And then really it's about strategizing on what actions might need to be taken as it relates to compensation. So with that said, I'm going to breeze past phase timeline because we have flexibility on timeline and what we might want to do here. So as the mayor and I discussed this, what he and I aligned on in terms of offering up to the group here and to the council here in a little bit is we think it might be a solid option to put together a Q&A session hosted by our team. That can be virtual, that could be in person, could be a combination of the two, to extend the dialogue, to have questions answered, to have anything that may come up after today's interaction really responded to well and articulated well, and just create a good set of mutual dialogue to identify whether or not this work makes sense and what pieces of this work may or may not make sense. From there, we would work towards a final scope of projects. What is the true need that you all have, and we'd specifically tailor that to meet your needs, both currently and in the future. And then from there, we would issue a proposal with a full presentation and discussion.
Clear as mud. Cam, a couple questions. I know that we've talked about a little bit that I don't think you hit on. One of the things too, and Julie, I don't know if you had some things you wanted to add or not, but public and private, you talked about your public partners, but you didn't talk about private partners.
Yeah, so we have our total client base within the team that sits in Indianapolis is about 300 clients. And that's made up of everything from groups that have two employees, all the way up to groups that have 4,500 employees. Most of our groups, however, are in that 50 employee to 250 employee space. Much like the fabric of Indiana, you have a lot of small employers, but then you also have a lot of mid-sized employers. So that's the makeup of our group. From an industry perspective, we do a lot with professional services. So think accounting firms, we have a couple of law firms, we have many cities and towns, we have a few manufacturers, and really it runs a pretty broad gamut of the groups that we serve.
And so when you're looking at how competitive people are, it's not just comparing public to public, because sometimes we get kind of stuck, what are other cities and towns paying, but really everybody's competing for people.
That's exactly right. So we look at things both geographically, independent of industry. So geographically independent of industry. So that's just the geographic area and not specific to the industry. Then we look industry specific or peer-to-peer, if you will. And then we look at those two things together, right? So it's really what sort of geographics are at play within your area, what sort of industry specific variables are in play, or how do you peer-to-peer compare, and then combining those two things from a benchmarking perspective to see how you compare against both of them together.
Another question I had was, you're not replacing our insurance company, you're working with us, work with them to do a much wider analysis than.
Yeah, that's exactly right. So we are not an insurance company. We cannot insure you. We cannot be the administrator of your plan. That is not what we do. We are simply a consulting firm. We were built on the benefits side of things. Right now, I think Dunn satisfies both the consulting piece and the administration of your plan. It's not that we are looking to replace Dunn, move Dunn, this, that, and the other. It's just that we are here presenting an opportunity to evaluate, you know, the setup of that architecture in that in the plan to determine whether or not it's working and what adjustments we might consider.
Any other questions for Cain? Does anybody want to, I've asked a couple times this year, anybody want to be kind of involved in this health insurance compensation committee? Because that's something we've talked about too, is really trying to figure out how we form that to have these more in-depth conversations. Because I think something came that we've talked about, and I know Julie and Amy and I talked about it too, as we look at down the road, obviously wages and cost of living and inflation are an effect of that. But sometimes we forget about the benefits, and that's where your company really specializes in how do we do this, as you call it, the total reward metric. It's not just about pay, but it's about all of this being balanced together. Is that fair?
Yeah, that's completely fair.
So it all goes hand in hand. But
I can make myself available.
Okay.
I'm good. I'm not wanting to be on this review necessarily. I would like to affirm the fact I think this can be helpful. I mean, I think we need to do that. So I'm supportive of this Q&A and looking at further to see if it really is going to be a fit for us, and how, you know, what kind of impact or effect it might have in terms of benefiting us in the long run. I'm supportive.
And I think that was the goal for this evening, is just information, kind of get a pulse for things before we start kind of maybe going deeper in the rabbit hole. The presentation to council is literally the same, but I know that they've had some questions as well. So, Dee, Rodney, anything else? Julie?
Yeah.
Come on up then.
Just what I'm seeing in my office, I think they could be very beneficial. Just not getting a lot of applicants. We had a full-time position open not too long ago. We had two applicants to pick from. Summer help is always an issue, or it has been the last 2 years. We just can't get enough people. I think they could really help with maybe some benchmarking to see where we're at pay-wise. I know we've got a lot of compression in some of our departments where we have, in one department, 5 employees making more than a department head. So I think they could really help out with, are we paying our people like we should? I think when you have a department, you want those employees to strive to be trained to maybe be a department head someday. And if they can't make more when they're a department head, why would you want to be that department head? So I think they can help too, because our compensation package is so rich, or benefits package is so rich. You know, we have a very good health insurance plan, but maybe we're not doing as well on the compensation, and make sure they even out a little bit better.
Okay.
Does that help?
Sure.
Okay.
Thanks for the insight.
Yep.
Okay. Anything else on this topic? Okay. Perfect. Thank you, Cam.
Yeah. Thanks, you again, for your time. Really appreciate it.
Up next, first item under new business, Sheri Slaven is here with the Caleb Brown Memorial 5K.
A little bit of a change this year.
Yes.
Good evening.
Thank you. I am here to present on behalf of the Caleb Brown Memorial 5K, and we've actually added a fun run as well. I think you all have a map of our route, and we are here on the board because we are moving back downtown to start downtown, opposed to out at the trail. And so I wanted to get your approval on that.
The route generally goes east on Washington, back on Central, all the way up to Baruchel,
mm-hmm.
on East Street, down Broadway.
Correct.
Right.
Correct. This is our fourth year. The first year the route was a little bit different than this route. This is the route we did the second year. Last year it moved out to the trail, and our attendance was down, and it causes a little bit of a divide between the Fall Festival and the 5K. So our hope is to bring that back together for the community to have one place, one central location.
It is Fall Festival weekend.
It is, right. yes. So we'll start at the stage right there downtown. We're actually adding a fun run as well. This year it's themed superhero, so it's for any age because our proceeds go to Special Olympics and those with special needs. So it's not necessarily a kid's fun run. It'll be open to any age, but it'll just go one lap around the courthouse and every participant will get an award. So an opportunity for those who are maybe not runners or walkers to still be a part of the cause.
And I assume you've spoken to Chief McNealy?
I have.
Okay. Chief, you okay with that?
Yeah, we had a nice meeting with their board.
Perfect. Yeah, so we have three officers who have, sworn officers who have volunteered to stand at some of the main major intersections such as Fairchild and Broadway, Lincoln and Central, and Lincoln and Washington. From there, we have nine locations that will have volunteers set up.
How many do you expect?
Participants?
Yep.
Or a lofty goal would be 150 to 200, we're hoping.
Any questions for Sheri?
September 17th. Mm-hmm. I have registration forms if you guys, if you would like.
Amy White.
I could probably do a fun run, that's about it.
Anything else?
Not
if not, we'll take a motion to approve that as presented. Motion's been made by Dee. Seconded by Glenn. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed? Perfect.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you for your support.
Yep, have a good evening. Good luck.
Thank you.
Up next, Police Chief Mike McNealy. We've got a few items. First item on the agenda, interview for new hires.
Yeah, so we did have a physical agility and written application process that has started. We're down to four to come in to do interviews with our department. We have that scheduled for the 20th of July and are looking for a date beyond that for you guys to be available for anybody that we bring for potential to hire. So ideally, end of July, first of August.
Does anyone have preference on the date?
I just would ask that it not be the 28th, 29th, or 30th. That of July.
Dates except for those and email them. How about that?
Sounds good to me.
That last week, so the week following your interviews.
How about we look at sometime in the first part of August? I'll send you guys an email. Okay.
I'm open. Typically have stuff Friday and Saturday with the farmers market, but I could make something work if it coincides.
Okay.
I prefer not the second if. Possible, or it'd be a little bit later that I could do it after 6 on the 2nd.
How about the 3rd? It's Wednesday. Would the 3rd work for you, Dr. King? Are you back by then?
No, that's okay. Okay. Proceed. Proceed without me.
Okay, will do.
Okay, second item, DLC contract for HVAC.
So I brought, you should have in your packet a briefing letter on our HVAC system at the police department, as well as a professional services letter agreement. Reached out to DLZ, who the city has worked with before on the building project here at City Hall. Originally reached out to a HVAC company who provided me with the name of an engineer. They came in and did a very brief walk through the building and gave me a quote, which I presented earlier in the year. I contacted that engineer back, and he said he would only provide me any information if I agreed to go with the company that he chose. I didn't particularly like that answer and didn't feel like it was service to the city to keyhole us into something, as well as this size project probably needs three quotes anyway. So contacted DLZ, they agreed to come in. Josh with DLZ is here and is available to answer any questions you have. Basically, the things that we talked about, or I mentioned in my letter, was it's a 20-year-old system that started kind of breaking down as pretty quickly after it was installed. We lost a main control board, and at the time, whoever was in charge decided not to replace it. I believe it was going out of warranty, and the parts weren't available. So we've had a lot of issues, humidity, which has created mold and mildew issues within the building we've had to deal with. We have uneven heating and cooling. We have differing temperatures, just one office away from each other. So they presented this letter. It's not for anything more than just scope of service for them to present, to come in, to do all the assessments, and to present plans for us to vote on at a later date. The number that they gave is, we believe, to be on the higher end of anything that we would be looking at. We've already talked about ways that we could save some money. There was potential of reutilizing part of the system. There's potential of us moving out of the building while they do some of the contract work to help speed along and as well as cheapen the price. And then I also presented to you two different options for funding the project. The first one being utilizing funds that are available currently within the city's different budgeting areas. And then the second would be a complete total project in next year's budget. However, that would create a very substantial deficit in next year's budget if you just said this is a project that we're going to fund. So what I'm looking for tonight is just for you guys to agree to this professional services letter agreement for DLZ to come in and to do the scope of service that they've said, which would be the schematic design, the construction documents, the bidding, and the construction administration, with the sum of that being $57,500.
My only request is that we not band-aid the project. This is the second building that we have dealt with this year that there were issues from the start. And we lived with one of them maybe 30 years, fire station. And the police building is 20 years old, and we've had issues from the very start where those problems should have been taken back to the builder immediately, and we stayed with it. I would hope that if you get what you need and Chief Stoermer gets what he needs, that we be good guardians of our buildings, and if we have problems that need to be addressed, that they get addressed and not allowed to carry on and on and on, that becomes more expensive each day.
That would be my plan.
Great.
I don't have a reason to say that we shouldn't, we need somebody to help guide through this. But my one question I do have is that if I read, and it's been a few days since I read this carefully, but the initial walkthrough, obviously maybe more cursory than, I'm assuming more cursory than what DLZ did, but because the difference between the project cost is like $500,000.
That is correct.
And I mean, when I see something like that, it makes you say, no, something's wrong here. So I guess I need some explanation as to why we see such a gap.
There's a huge disparity in the amounts. I believe, and I think it's why he was trying to keyhole us into one specific company, was he was quoting what that company is comfortable working with, the type of equipment that they provide, and the type of service that they do, whereas DLZ being an independent engineer, they're not, they're just gonna say, here are the two types of two, three, whatever projects they come up with. Here's the cheap version, here's the mid version, here's the high version. In the cheap version, maybe. We talked about it. He thought 150 sounded very low for a cheap version to fix it, but maybe a little bit more than that. I think that's where the disparity is you have somebody that says, I want you to use me, but you have to use this person, as opposed to somebody that says, I'll provide you with these three different options, and you can choose what works best for you. That amount, that the total amount that he gave us, I think would be on the high end of that project list.
Josh, would you want to speak to some of the things that you've kind of discovered as you walk through it as well?
Yeah, so Josh Atley with DLZ, our senior mechanical engineer. So we did a cursory review just when we were asked to submit a fee proposal. So it was maybe about a half hour, 45 minutes we walked through the building to take a look on what we thought the issues were. And much as you were saying that the city is not interested in a Band-Aid fix, and as part of our fee proposal, we have an outline that we would provide a schematic design submittal. And to what the chief was saying, the intent there would be we would provide a couple options on, hey, you can do this type of system, we believe would solve the issue, maybe a little bit on the higher end of the cost. Here's another option to utilize as much of the existing system as possible, but we're not, again, it's not a Band-Aid though. And part of that schematic design would be to better dial in what those costs are. So we did provide a range, but again, it was a range on a 30 to 45 minute walkthrough, and just some general, what we know from my experience on recent projects that have been of, here's a range of the cost, but the idea of that schematic design is to really dial in and give the city a better idea of, hey, here'd be the systems, here are what we anticipate the costs on current climate. Do we want to proceed, or how do we want to proceed? So understand, I just want everybody to understand, we have a number that's there, but that's going to be better defined as we do the schematic design. And then even as, if we're lucky enough to work with the city on the project, even as we move through construction, there would be cost estimate there toward the construction documents, the final design. There would be a cost estimate at the end of that too for discussion to make sure we're still on track with everything. So we do have that set up on the design side to go through that process and work with the city on what needs to be done. So hopefully that provides a little bit better clarity.
The agreement that you've provided has kind of four phases: the design, construction, bidding, and construction administration. So that is from today through completion of the project.
Correct.
Yep. So it's, here's the fee to do it all.
Correct.
Second question on that, if we get to the end of phase one and we deem the project not to be viable, can we step away from that?
I believe so. I will confirm that with you, Mayor. I would assume that's the case. Maybe we need to revise a little bit how we put that together in this letter just to make that so that it is an option. But I mean, that's not unusual that I've seen on other projects. And that's why we do phase it the way we do, because obviously don't want to pay for something and then the project doesn't continue. But I would need to talk with Eric Grants on our end just to confirm that. But I will get back to you tomorrow morning on that for sure.
I understand you would need to budget. You talked about budgeting the project, but is the amount to pay DLZ for their services in your budget?
That's what we're asking for, and that scope of letter tonight is the $57,500. We're not asking for a decision on how to finance it tonight, just to approve them to go ahead and move forward with the schematic design, the construction documents, bidding, and the construction administration, which I assume you guys wouldn't do the construction administration if we stopped.
They have money in the general obligation bond for this project, so we would use those funds to pay for this, and then the rest of the fund options that Chief and I laid out would be how we actually fund the real project.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah. So the money for this is already in the budget.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Another thing to note, I think it's valuable if you decide to approve this, that we do it on the condition of receiving favorable feedback from council at the next meeting, because they're the ones that are really going to have to make the decision on whether to fund it this year in additional appropriations, budget it in next year, or do additional appropriations next year. Josh, do you have a timeline that you think that this could potentially go to letting if we moved at a reasonable pace?
As far as between when awarded to when it would go up for bid,
yeah.
Is that what you're asking? I believe we had a time frame. We had 4 weeks for the schematic design portion, and then upon approval of the approach, another 12 weeks for the design side. So you're looking roughly in that 16-week time frame, give or take a little bit, obviously, once we provide the information to the city on, you know, making the decision whether to go ahead or not. But that's about the time frame we're looking at. Bidding would be then another about 4 weeks, and then just because the chief and I were talking about this before the meeting, when you see the construction timeline that we have in our fee proposal, that's taken into account from when it's awarded, shop drawings from the contractor, our review lead times. I'm trying to take lead times into account because, as a lot of people know, it's lead times for equipment's pretty hit or miss right now on length. So just want to make it aware that I don't believe it's 36 weeks of hard construction, but it's building in a lot of that other part of the process. So I did want to clarify that as well.
So you're talking about December. Does that present a problem?
For us?
Yeah, no, I don't see any issues with it because the system replacement, it's different than a larger building where you're replacing just a chiller or a boiler. I mean, what's going in here is heating and cooling, and of course there'd be more conversations if the building's occupied and what needs to be done on that end. But I don't see, whether it's December, I don't see a particular issue. The of the construction itself was about 36 weeks is what I was estimating.
36 weeks?
Yeah. And as part of during the schematic design too, I would reach out to some contractors I've worked with and I know over the years, or even if the city has a mechanical contractor they trust. I have no problem, I think it's a good idea to reach out to schematic design to even talk to them to get a better idea on some of those construction timelines and items like that again, so the city can make have it be able to make an educated decision on it.
Okay. Any other questions for Josh or the chief? If not, would entertain a motion to approve this pending favorable conversation with the council in the next meeting. Motion's been made by Rodney. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Glenn. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed. Perfect. Thank you. Appreciate it. Up next, vehicle purchases.
Okay, so vehicle purchasing in the year of 2022 is a little different than we've had to do in many years past. One issue we've had was the vehicle that we normally choose to purchase for use was not produced this year at all. We were told it was going to be, and then at the last second they said, well, they're not going to produce any fleet vehicles of that model. So we were not able to purchase the Ford utilities that we've been purchasing for the past few years. Which left us in a little bit of a lurch because that's kind of what we were banking on. So we started looking around everywhere else, and by waiting for those vehicles to be ready to go, everything else pretty much got sold out in the state, unless you wanted to purchase a very large SUV. I know that other department heads are having the same issue that I am of finding vehicles, fleet vehicles right now. I did locate some 2002 Dodge Charger Police Pursuit cars. They're all-wheel drive, six-cylinder. We have some of these in service right now in our fleet. They're serving us well. We don't have a problem using them. We like the utilities a little bit more just for the room. I've been told there are some officers that prefer the car as opposed to the utility. So I reached out to them. They provided us with pricing for the vehicles. They are currently sitting on their lot and ready to be purchased and picked up. The price on those was $41,590. Also presented to you in paper copy the price it would cost to outfit those cars. The price on that second page is for outfitting two vehicles instead of one. And what I would like to do is propose, we were had anticipating buying 3 utility vehicles this year. So what I'm proposing is that we just buy 2 chargers this year, and I will utilize the existing money in that line that we had set aside to actually purchase equipment for the utility vehicles next year. I've talked to our Ford dealer. He knows that they're producing them next year. He's just waiting on them to open up the date so that we can start. I talked to our rep today, who we purchased our equipment from, and he said even if we purchased that equipment and it was, we were not going to end up using it, it could be returned without issue. Maybe a small restocking fee. So that would be my proposal, is that you approve to purchase 2 of the 2022 Dodge Charger Police Pursuit cars and the equipment to outfit them, and then to utilize the additional funding to purchase equipment for next year's vehicles.
Will there be any additional parts that need that are not on the list?
Not on those lists, no. Those are complete. We've been over those 4 times now, and I think we got it all there.
Okay.
And you do have sufficient?
Yes.
Budgeted?
I do. It's already in the budget.
So what will you be doing with the ones that these are replacing?
Yeah, so they will be replacing a 2015 Ford Explorer Utility with 92,928 miles and a 2016 Dodge Charger with 83,612 miles. And John Jones is interested in both of those vehicles as long as we don't take the light bar or siren off of it.
So you had anticipated getting 3 this year, but you will be getting 2. Is that going to put you in a shortage of, fit vehicles to do the job?
No, I think we'll be fine. What we are doing is from the 3 that we bought last year, we are keeping 1 of those, and it actually will create finally a pool car back in our fleet that we didn't have before. And it is it's a well-kept Ford utility.
Any other questions for the chief on that? If not, we'll take a motion to approve the 2 2022 Chargers.
So
motion's been made by Dee.
Second
by Rodney. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed. Perfect.
Thank you, Board.
Chief Stoermer, teaching service and training.
Good evening. Good evening, Board. In your package, you have a memo as well as a quote for services for rope training. It was found through an audit out of our HR office through some work that some of our members are needing rope rescue technician level training. And because of the timeline and deadline to do that, instead of making that an internal type of training, I felt it best to outsource this to a third-party company who is made up of off-duty firefighters just outside of the Indianapolis area that is willing to come into Greensburg to teach it for us. The price listed is a price per student, and as you see listed there, I have a not-to-exceed amount as well. So we are hoping, I do have this in budget. This will be actually taken out of the training due to the fact of these discipline is used or could be used potentially at Honda. Majority of what we do out there with heights and ropes and things like that. So wanted to bring that, looking for the not to exceed amount of, I believe I said $6,500.
Oh, is that total?
Total, yes. So that would be, it's $500 or student. So then I think that was like 11 or 12 students, something like that.
Yeah, I see 13 students.
13 students, yeah. I failed math, so I'm sorry.
What percentage of the work of the crew is that?
So we actually have, 10 that need it, so that would be roughly a third. So this, we have 10 that need it, and then I also built in case somebody else wants to take it, that either has it as a refresher, because the state does not require that certification be anything done to uphold that certification. So if you don't use it, you lose it. I did want to build in some of that to allow individuals, if they wanted to take it again, to take it if they wanted to.
So will that mean that after these 10 or 13 students take it, everyone have taken it at some point?
Yes. Okay. Yes, everybody will have had it at some point, had a class that is comparable to that. One of our individuals has a certificate, but it's not the same class or the same certificate. It's a different training organization, but the material is the same. And that would get all of those individuals then, with the exception of anybody that we would hire on, we would have to work at it. But this will knock out the majority of those that need it, allowing us to kind of get caught back up, and then more on an individual basis do this, and then we can send those individuals out versus having them to come here.
Out of curiosity, how much does it cost to send one firefighter out for that training?
So they would charge that. The company that I'm contracting with does like a school every spring, and they open that up, and it's still $500. It's just the travel expense. It's that other kind of add-on stuff that we don't have to do here. You know, it is a mandated class, so there will be overtime, and there will be coverage charges that have to take place as well. This, we have that already built into our budget. This would be just for the actual training itself.
After the officers are finished with the training, will it necessitate purchasing any new equipment?
It should not. We have just purchased within the last 2 years around $5,000 of rope rescue equipment. So if anything, it will allow them better to use that. We replace ropes as they expire, and pulleys as they become outdated and worn, and that's usually just taken out of our normal operating budget.
Any other questions for Nate on this? If not, we'd entertain a motion to approve as presented.
So moved.
Motion's been made by Dee, second by Glenn. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Thank you. Amy, you had an additional claim.
Yes, that was just turned in or submitted on my viewpoint today. That needs that was not on the claims list. That needs to be paid by August 6th, so I need that to be, I'm trying to log in to get that, it kicked me out. It is a Motorola bill for the police. It is in addition to their regular monthly Motorola bill. Mike, do you want to explain what it's for?
Absolutely.
'Cause I have to.
So this is a radio to go in, since we did keep the one car to add that pool car back into our fleet. We were short one car radio, so this just adds that car radio back into a police car. And I think it was
$5,268.56. He says radio. There's a list this long of things that are actually itemized out.
It's all the cables, connectors, the remote head that goes in the front of the car, the radio actually sits in the back of the car, the antenna, all that stuff.
Are we okay with adding
in
that
addition
to the claims?
To
include,
yes.
All the new approved claims. You don't have to make a motion.
Second.
For all the claims. Motion's been made to pay all the bills by Rodney, second by Glenn. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed. Okay, four quick things. We have the veterans banners that have been put up and down Lincoln and Veterans Way by the Bicentennial Committee. There is a kind of an unveiling ribbon cutting happening Friday, July 22nd at noon on the front lawn of the Decatur County Memorial Hospital. I would invite everyone to attend that. Of course, we are getting ready for National Night Out coming August 18th to North Park. The park will be done. It's on record that it will be done. And we'll be back out there. We've been working very closely with the Parks Department on that. Mark and Ron and Dave O'Meara's crews have been doing fantastic work for us. We have a water plant open house coming August 20th. That is a Saturday. We obviously have opened the water plant during the coronavirus outbreak and have never been able to show the public our tremendous investment. And so we will be hosting that. Rick will be hosting that at his facility on Saturday, August 20th. More information to come on that. We have had our pre-construction meeting and been working with and through the process with our contractor for the parking lot, so that will be underway by the time we meet next month, hopefully. And there will be a lot of operational changes with the drive-throughs. We're going to try to keep it open as long as we can, while plenty of signage available, and are excited to get that project underway yet this summer and hopefully completed by early fall. Anything else to come before the board? If not, would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Motion's been made by Glenn. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Thanks, everyone. Thank you.